I'm curious about like messages that you may have received in your family, specifically about dating white people.
My mom has said I should not date white people in general. She's like very like, you need to date an African guy because that's where our culture is and everything like that. But like, I grew up in a PWI, so like, I'm kind of like, I'm like, it's something that I'm like more used to. And like, so like, that's kind of what I'm going to be end up being attracted to because that's what I'm always around. But my mom is kind of like, no. And one time I mentioned to my mom, this one guy, and she goes, is that a white guy? And I was like, yeah. And she goes, oh my gosh. And so like, it's just kind of really funny. Like it's just not, you really just can't like force yourself who you're going to like because what your parents want, honestly.
When I was younger, my dad liked to blame Disney Channel and Zac Efron for my preference. Because I was all about, you know, Jonas Brothers and Zac Efron as Troy Bolton. He was like, this is not okay. He was like, your attitude and your, like, taste. But I think, you know, I've grown up, you know, they've become a lot more accepting. I am the oldest, so my mom, with my little brother, she's always been like, you're going to have a beautiful Chinese bride, da da da. Well, my brother's in a relationship. She's not Asian. Sorry, mom. But, you know, they kind of got over that and are very supportive of that aspect. But again, like Mide has said, I have been through PWIs my whole life. And that kind of, you know, influenced my preference. But when I was younger, I hated being Asian. And, like, that hurts me to say. Sorry. I'm like, I always get teary-eyed about it. Like,
it's okay.
It's hard to like say it now and really think back. I always said I didn't want to date someone who was Asian, who was the same race when I was younger, which is crazy to talk about now. But you know, as I've grown up, like I've really opened myself to that aspect, and you know, I can say yes, I like that Asian man. He looks, you know, he's attractive to me, which I don't think I could have said when I was younger.
And when I think about that piece that we talked about earlier around self-love, I think that's a piece of it, right? Just like, you know, yes, boundaries, yes, you know, showing up for your needs, but also accepting yourself in your fullness, including your racial identity. And I think what can become difficult when dating is just all the messages that people are projecting onto you and messages you may internalize about attractiveness and, you know, your proximity to whiteness. And it's like, okay, my hair's too kinky, my skin is too dark. Like, yes, I'm Asian. Like, all of these things that impact, like, how we could, like, even navigate in those dating circles. And part of the reason why I asked that question about like, you know, messages about like dating someone white specifically is because I remember like even talking with friends, but also my own experience, like hearing family talk about, well, like, yeah, you need to date someone white so you can advance the race, right? It's better if you date someone white, then your babies will be light skin. And one of my cousins, she married a white man. My grandmother was over at my apartment and she was talking to one of our other cousins about the baby that they just had. And she was saying that the baby is so beautiful, you know, he has beautiful skin. He's nice and light, right? And I'm just like, here I am, super chocolate and all. I'm like, well, grandma, come on, you know? But it's like, I don't think she's conscious of the things that she's saying. And I think she means it, right? So for a long time, like growing up, I didn't like my dark skin. I didn't think that people would like me because of my dark skin.
It's funny that you were saying how your grandmother was like, the baby has light skin, like, so beautiful. I come from a ethnicity where we come in all different shades, colors, sizes. Like, I have cousins that are a lot darker than me, and then I have cousins who have blonde hair and blue eyes. And, like, in the eyes of, like, my family, like, it's always been, like, lighter is more beautiful. Like, my parents were always like, oh, like, maybe you can find a white man or something like that. And it was just very, like, odd because, like, in our culture, like the lighter you are, like the more beautiful you are. It's weird. Mm-hmm. It's very weird. But I think that all is generational, so.
It's generational and it's also being passed down, you know, and I think some of these things just happen unconsciously, right? Like I remember talking with someone that mentioned like they used to put bleach in their water when they would take a bath thinking that it would make their skin lighter, right? And it's just like, these are the messages that it can be passed down if we're not intentional about deconstructing those messages and like just reframing the narrative, right? There's nothing wrong with being light-skinned, and there's nothing wrong about embracing and loving your dark skin, right? And everything in between. It's just an ongoing challenge because, like, these messages are also reinforced in schools and everything. And it's like, okay, here's this class photo and the one Black person in the classroom you can't see because the people don't know how to work with lighting for melanated skin, right? Things like that. And people, because I remember having that experience, and, like, it's just so isolating and it's uncomfortable and it's awkward, especially when you're younger. But even if you're not younger, like, people, like, making fun of you, and it's just like, oh my gosh, you know, you're so dark, can't even see you in this picture, right? So I think that there's a lot of work to be done in terms of, like, the people that are entrusted with children to mold them, and, you know, institutions and the space that we offer to have these conversations.
When I was in middle school, this one guy said, I don't like you because you're too dark. So then I went on YouTube and I was like, how to make your skin lighter. And I was, and which is like really upset. My mom like found out that I was like trying to lighten my skin. She goes, you can't be doing this and everything. Like, so like she had a whole talk with me about like self-love and like loving your skin and things like that. But like thinking back on it, it's kind of upsetting that like that those words hurt me to the point where I like try to change my physical appearance.
I think that really boils down to like the beauty myth and like what people really deem as beautiful. And it also kind of circles back to that comment of, you know, when men put women against each other.
Yeah.
You know, when I was younger, I really wanted to be blonde with blue eyes. I got colored contacts. I did dye my hair to be, I guess, marketable in the dating world, dating scene. You know, it's something that you navigate growing up. It's hard, you know, sometimes it's like, how do I curl my hair when my hair is like, just sticks straight and it doesn't hold the curl, but everyone else has, you know, voluminous curls and that's beautiful. Or my eyelids. That's what monolids or, you know, hooded eyes. Like, I can't do makeup. Like, how do I navigate that? Because all the people that I'm watching or, you know, are I'm influenced by don't look like me.
Yeah, absolutely. Because you can work on it all you want. And like we've talked about like this, you know, this journey to self-love and how that shows up in relationships and dating and stuff. Like, it's a process. But sometimes, like, you may take 2 steps forward and 5 steps back because sometimes, like, the things that you're working on aren't validated in the spaces that you're in.
I think that also, like, really just stems from, I think, all these problems, how you view yourself versus people's perception of you. And then what I mean by that is, how much do you love yourself? How much are you willing to compromise yourself for other people versus what do they see you as? I think going back to the angry Black woman narrative and my old school that I went to, it was PWI2. And I remember every time I would voice my opinion, it was like, oh, calm down, Tamara, you're angry. But anytime white girls would do it, they'd be like, oh, they're just expressing their emotions. And I was like, so how come I'm not expressing my emotions? How much do you love yourself and how much are you willing to change for somebody? Like, I know there's a lot of gaslighting that happens in friendships, relationships, any type of ships, that people are like, oh, if you love me, you change this, you do this. But it's like, if you love me, you would accept me for who I am and not just who you want me to be. So I think that's, it goes back to self-love, definitely, because that's very important. And self-love is the best love. Before you can have any type of friends, any type of relationships, you have to learn to love yourself and you have to learn to love who you are and what you want to be and not what people want you to be.
You should love yourself. And I feel like I definitely have learned that throughout my college experience. Like, friends come and go like the wind. Mm-hmm. And yes, it hurts. I feel like friendship breakups hurt more than relationship breakups. Personally, I've gone through like friendship breakups that have taught me how I wasn't loving myself and now how I am loving myself because I've taken myself out of friendships.
I think that's absolutely spot on. I think it's really interesting that like there's not a lot of like space to grieve the loss of a friend, not necessarily due to death, but just like the separating of friends. And I think that's really important. I really appreciate you sharing that because like if you, like I think the only thing that really, maybe not the only thing, but one of the major things that distinguishes between a friendship and a relationship is like that romantic aspect. But you're still intimate with your friends, right? There's still like a lot of space holding between friends. And I think that is equally important as the space that you create in a romantic relationship. I was gonna say entanglement, but this is not the red table talk.